Back in the late 50s, there was a pastor in the old church here named Charles Jones. And I think me and Betty, but I don't remember him. But I was just 11, 12 years old in there, that range. And he would put a slip of paper in song books. And it started out like a dollar. And if you got, kid got that song book with a dollar, that's, he'd give them a dollar. But he got so popular, he started putting 2 50-cent ones. Then he got down, he started a quarter of a piece and put 4, so there'd be more of us that would win. And you could get a drink, candy, and get change back then, 25 cents. One thing about it, he didn't have no. See? It'll take 20 to do it now. And I'm tempted to try it. See, we can fill up the choir. We said he was right to pay these kids to come up there. He sure inspired us to do it. Amen. Amen. And this is one of the songs. I remember way back when I was just a kid, page 92. Amen. All right. When the way seems dark and long, as I tell how good a song leader I am. I can even see a book.
Thank you, son. Thank you, son. Now you see.
Y'all were going right along with me like I knew what I was doing, didn't you? Amen. Yeah, we were walking with Jesus now. Amen.
When the way seems dark and
oh,
Houston sang Sweet Hour Prayer. Got so lazy now, it's just a little talk. Well, I didn't say, I just repeat.
Our pain.
before I started preaching, I did preliminaries in the church. And, man, I got a lonely, we'd have a big time. Amen. We're going to go to and take up the tithes and offerings at this time. Brother Thornton, do you feel that standing and pray over the tithes and offerings today?
Yeah. The tithes, Lord. We ask you to bless and sanctify that go to the distance of the church, Lord. We pray in all the name of Jesus. Amen.
Family night, the WMs had 25 and the men had 17.
Yeah. Amen.
Amen. That's much as we've ever run. Amen. They're doing projects and we're doing projects. And just if you're not involved, just get in, bro. We have a good time. Amen.
Leaving, I never get lost.
breath we take is only by the grace of God.
Amen.
And Brenda sang that song, the next step you take could be on the streets of pure gold. The next touch you feel, be touching your soul. Amen. So we don't know what our next breath's going to be, but we can't even walk without holding his hand. Amen. Amen. Where somebody say praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Amen. Don't forget the announcements. Amen. If you can get over to Brother Thornton's. Amen. I believe they're singing. I got one more thing I figured out about last night's bowling. I could hit a strike or a spare, and I think I got it down pat now. And the next ball would either go in the gutter or just hit one pin. And I figured it out this morning. I had a hypocrite ball. It didn't know which way it wanted to go.
Put some holy water on it or something.
Yep. Amen.
Anoint it with the oil.
Sometimes I get my Bible and concordance out and start reading and asking God for directions and for the messages. And run references or whatever. And I think that I got the mind of God. And I may go lay down for get ready and go on to bed and lay there thinking. And all of a sudden he'll show me something that, and I know that I can't get it off my mind. And I know it's his will, so I'm going to do my best to preach from a scripture that I guess I have preached from this story probably more times than like any other, because I get so many different thoughts out of it. And last night I was saying, Lord, you know, they've heard me preach from this story before, but you never heard you preach it like this. And so we're going to the 15th chapter of the book of St. Luke. Probably more than one. We'll just go by his leading and read this familiar story in the 15th chapter, beginning in the 11th verse of St. Luke. This is Jesus speaking. And he said a certain man had two sons. When the Bible says, Jesus says, a certain man or a certain, and the word certain is used, it's not a parable. Amen. A certain man, you know, had his crops, was blessed. I'll tear down my barn to build it. Well, anyhow, where it says certain man, there was a man at this time Jesus referred to that had two sons. And the younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the portion of goods that falleth to me. And he divided them his living. Notice it says, and he divided unto them, and meant him and his brother, his living. And not many days after the younger. Now the brother had, the older brother could have done the same thing because he divided unto them. I want you to get that. Amen. Is that what it says anyhow? His living. And not many days after, the younger son gathered all together and took his journey to a far country, and there wasted his substance with riotous living. And when he had spent all, there arose a mighty famine in that land, and he began to be in want. And he went and joined himself to a citizen of that country, and he sent him into his fields to feed swine. And he would fain have filled his belly with the husk that the swine did eat, and no man gave unto him. Look where all of his friends and buddies was at. No man. sent him out to feed the swine without food. My God, no man gave unto him. And he would have filled his belly with the husk that the swine did eat, and no man gave unto him. And when he came to himself, he said, how many hired servants of my father's have bread enough and to spare, and I perish with hunger. I will arise and go to my father, and will say unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before thee, and am no more worthy to be called thy son. Make me as one of thy servants. Make me as one of thy servants. Brother Corey, would you pray?
Dear Lord God, we thank you for being able to come into your house once again, God. We thank you for the reading of the word, Lord God. We ask you, Lord God, that you would anoint our pastor, God, as you bring forth the word. Lord God, let it touch every heart, soul, and mind.
Yes,
Jesus.
Amen. I would like to start off saying, young man, what were you thinking? You know what he was thinking? If I get all of that money, I can go out there away from daddy, and I can go out there in the worldly places, and I can do things I can't do here at the Father's house. I can go out and I can have me a grand time. I can go with my friends, and we're going to have a great time with the money that I've got. He didn't know that after he was broke in the family, what was going to happen to him. I like to start off saying, what was he thinking? To leave a place where he had servants to wait on him. We had a hot meal every day, probably three times a day. His flesh drove him away from that. That was the greatest blessing he could have on the side of this earth. And so his flesh said, let's go have a good time. And the only way I can have that good time that I hear these people talking about in that far land is if I have money. So I ask for mine inheritance, that's coming unto me. And the father could have refused. That was to give to him after his death. But if he so desired, his lords would say that he could give them to him before he died. But he could have refused. Because he knew what the boy was going to do. And he knew what the boy was going to get in a mess, no doubt, when he run out of money. Boy, the devil will let you have a good time, but he'll run out.
Right.
Amen. There's many that are doing that today. They're giving up the Lord because the flesh wants to have a good time. Amen. And so he did that. And I'm trying to get to where God laid on my heart. So he did that. And sure enough, he was having a good time. But then he got down. They were having a hard famine. He didn't have no more money. Nobody to help him. And the Bible says that he got more or less hired on to do the lowest job in that land and all over Israel and all over the far country we was at. Amen. Feeding hogs. And while he was out there, the Bible said no man gave him something to eat. He got hungry. He got hungry. And he would, the Bible said, he would fain have filled his belly with what he was supposed to feed the hogs, which would have really got him in trouble. But a husk is a little dry something that's coarse and dry. Anybody's ever seen a corn husk? Dry corn. Got all kind of fiber in it. Most of them do. They're not good to chew. But when you're hungry and nobody's there to give you, you'll eat even what the hogs was given to them. And I could see before he did it, he said, I'm perishing with hunger. But then he says, he came to himself. He came to himself. What was he thinking in the hog pen? I tell you what he was thinking. I wish I'd have never left home. I tell you what he was thinking. He was thinking, amen, about them hot meals he could be having instead of that dry husk in his hand. I tell you what he was thinking. It's better to be in the Father's house than it is to be in the devil's house. Can I tell you, young people and old, it's better to be in the Father's will than be in the will of the flesh that will never satisfy you. Amen. It's better to be where God can bless you. Don't leave where God can bless you to go to something, amen, that will satisfy the flesh. Well, praise God. I believe he was thinking that. And I believe the thought come to him as he came to himself, if I go back home, I can ask my Father to forgive me. I don't know if he will. I wasted money that he had saved and offered me and my brother. Not wasting my part. I don't know how my Father's going to feel towards me. I don't know, but I'm going to at least take a chance. And then he got so remorseful in the hog pen that he had him a speech of repentance. He said, if I can just get to my Father, I'll tell him that I have sinned against him, I have sinned against heaven, and I'm no more worthy to be called thy son. He didn't go and say, let me see what I can compromise and see what I can say to make it feel sound good, the reason that I'm coming home. No, if he'd have done that, his Father never would have welcomed him like he did. But he said, I've got a prayer of repentance. I'm going to ask God to forgive me. I'm going to ask my Father to forgive me and to help me and to make me one of his servants. I don't even want him to claim me as his son, but the servants has got more than what I'm down here in this place where I went and wasted all of my substance. Amen. I want to tell you more. If you don't ever think God got more for you than the world does, you need to shake yourself before you find yourself in the hog pen, amen, and in a mess that you can't get out of. So in the hog pen, I believe he was in the hog pen that he made his confession. He got under conviction. You don't hear that preach no more. But he got under conviction, Brother Ralph, of what he had done. And he said, if I could just get home, I'll tell my Father. If you read the whole story, the Father, when he got to him, he wasn't the first one to speak. The boy was. He says, Father, I have sinned. I have sinned against you and against God. I've sinned. Go on now. What happened? When the Father seen him afar off. Can I tell you, the Bible doesn't tell it, but I believe the same road that carried him to the far country was the same road that brought him back home. And I believe that when the Father seen him at a distance, he kept looking. I believe his heart began to beat fast. Is that my boy? Got tattered clothes, messed up hair, no shoes. But it looks like it might be my son. I'll go out there and I'll grab the biggest limb I can find. And I'll beat him half to death. And I'll tell him, you sorry thing, what are you doing back here? You spent all that I saved for you. Amen. And I don't want you nothing else to do with you. I'm going to beat you till you can't hardly stand it. You want me to make you one of my servants? I ain't even going to do that, boy. Get out of here. No, sir. No, sir. You see, though he was gone, and though he had broke his father's heart, he still loved him. Can I get an amen? I want to speak on love here for a minute. Stay with me. Amen. If you get mad at somebody preaching love, then you need to repent somewhere or another. Say amen, somebody. I want to tell you, it doesn't matter what you're doing out there in the world, the Father still loves you. I said, the Father still loves you. That is my son. And I'm running out there not with a stick, not with a limb to beat him, but I'm running to him in love. And I'm going to grab him around the neck, and I'm going to love him, and I'm going to put a robe on his stinking clothes, and I'm going to give him some best shoes and put them on his feet. I'm going to put a ring on his finger, and that ring is what I want to preach on just a little bit. Will you help me? Amen. He put a ring on his finger, which symbolizes unbroken love. When I marry a couple and they have rings, I say, this is not an ornament or a piece of jewelry. It symbolizes the unbroken love you could have, you're to have for your husband and your wife. Can you get a good amen? Y'all not liking it, but it's the way it is anyhow. The unbroken love. Amen. One guy was married to somebody. He should have said, till death do us part. He said, until you stop loving one another. God help him. My God, somebody say amen. He said, I love you with an unbroken love. I don't care what you've done. It doesn't matter no more when you're home. He kissed him. He kissed him. Hugged him. Robed him. Give him his best shoes. Give him a good ring. What was he saying? What did he Father, I've sinned. What was he saying? Son, I forgive him. I don't know for what you've done. And you'll never get back what you lost in my house. You done wasted it. But I love you. I've never stopped loving you. I didn't know where you was at. I didn't know who you was with. I didn't know if you was dead or alive. Come on now. But I want you to know regardless. I look for you coming down that road every day. Come said, it doesn't matter. I loved you that much. Amen. Oh, what greater love, my friend, we should have for one another. Amen. Unbroken love. You mean to tell me, Daddy, that while I was out there, amen, I wasn't even thinking about home until I got in the hog pen, and you still loved me even then? I still loved you, son. I didn't know what you was doing. I didn't know what danger you was in, but I still love you. Glory to God for that. I mean, remembers, and I'm sure he wouldn't mind me repeating it, Brother Pooler. His story. How many of you was here tonight? He preached it or told about it. His story. Because as a young man, he had a godly daddy. I believe his daddy was a minister. I'm talking about Dwayne Poole. Now he's pastor of Lake Butler Church of God. Jeremy Poole's daddy. He said, I run. And he said, I got in with a bad crowd and drugs and the best I can remember, he said they had him down in a basement like. It was a bad crew. And I guess they afraid to. He was going to tell them or something. They was talking about killing him. And somebody there, a woman or a girl or a buddy or whatever, got to him and said, you better get out of here. Get out of here now. His hair had grown real long. He stunk. And he called his daddy. To send him a ticket for a bus ticket to come home. Brother Poole's daddy sent him the money. He called the bus and come home. His daddy was waiting at the bus station. And he had gotten so thin and stunk and long hair, raggedy clothes. And he said his daddy didn't even recognize him. But his daddy, when he recognized old Dwayne, and give him a big hug, Dwayne broke down and knew that his father loved him no matter how he treated him. He loved him. That's agape love. That love doesn't come from the flesh. It comes from above. and sometimes I've needed a godly love. Hey, come on now. Sometimes if you hadn't needed it already, you're going to need a godly love. It doesn't come from what you feel in the flesh. You want to knock a mountain and beat them down. Amen. But agape love says, I'll grab you and I'll hug you and I'll forgive you. Come on home, son. We got a McGill meal waiting on you. Hallelujah. Come on. You go, servants, hear me. This is my son. Y'all don't remember him. You go home and you get the fatty cat. Don't get that old scrawny thing that's about to die. You get that I've got fattened up for a special occasion. You go get that for my son. Saved and filled with the Holy Ghost, married a godly woman, evangelized for years, been here for many times in revival, and now pastoring her church. Amen. If the daddy had that agape love, he could have never been what he is now. Can I say amen? And if Jesus didn't have that love for you, you would never be sitting here going to heaven. Amen. He wouldn't love you because of what you've done. He loved you in spite of what you've done. I feel the Holy Ghost right. Call upon thee, saith the Lord. If you want my anointing and power in your life, you must even love the unlovable. I will give you that strength, and I only can give you that love. Oh, glory. Hear what the Spirit saith unto the church. Brother Ronnie, that's kind of tough. I don't know if I can do that. You can't. But he that's within you can. For his strength is perfected in what you can't do on your own.
Amen.
Through the many years, and I'll try to close. I've had people to lie. It's a hard thing to defend a lie. A lie is serpent love for being truth to get its shoes on. God told me one time I was burdened, was going to go straighten the lie out. He stopped me. I was at the altar, the old church started leaving. He stopped me right by halfway off. He said, I know the truth, and the truth is what I best. Don't you worry about the lies. I'll take care of them that believe it and them that tell it. But some of them were serious. And some of them I had to fight bitterness and hate. I didn't have to pray one time over it. I had to seek God over it for, I'm talking about weeks, one time for months. You stand a minute, son. But I found out, if I didn't, my anointing was going to lose. Calvin, you may say and do something about me that really hurts me deep. Hurts my family. I don't know if you hurt me then. But if you say something about me to hurt me, you're just saying it, Brother Ronnie, because you're a pastor. But I'm telling you, I can't preach this unless I lived it.
That's right.
But because I've lived it, I can preach it. But you want it or not, wave at me. Here's what I do, son. Calvin, how you doing, buddy?
Hello.
Because you see, my anointing means more to me than what Calvin done to me. Thank you, Sister Patsy, for obeying God. It means more to me. Even if I feel like I did nothing wrong. Calvin, I love you. Because it was hurting them more than I'd let it hurt me. Because the anointing. You say, Brother Ronnie, you got Bible for that? Yeah, and it's a scripture nobody likes. It's one of them scriptures. If you have an ought, or you got a problem with a brother or a sister, Jesus said, you go to them. Don't go to everybody else. Go to them. Go to them and say, Calvin, I don't like what you've done, but I want you to know I still love you. I still want to worship with you. Then I can offer my sacrifice to Bible says. Hello? Because it means more to me than my own personal feelings. Son, I love you. Now let's go home and have a feast. The elder brother, and I'm trying to, the elder brother heard the shouting and the partying going on at his house. He was out in the field working where the younger man should have been. And he asked one of the servants, he said, what's going on up at the house? He said, your brother that was lost has come home. And your daddy has killed and butchered a fatted calf. Boy, we got a bunch of beef on the table. And we're having a time rejoicing because your brother's come home. What? Daddy has done that. Should have killed him. He never done that for me. Never. And the father heard he was out there pouting. You know, that's a pastor's job, is to go to folks that are pouting. Carrying pacifiers. Old Brother Wendell Pittman says, I didn't mind when I was pastor carrying pacifiers to Christians, but he said when I had to part the beer to get it in there, something wrong. Y'all get that tomorrow. Say amen. When you mature enough, because I ain't going to let that hinder me from getting the anointing and the power with God. That ain't gonna stop me to do what I know to do is right, Brother Thorne. Thank you for agreeing with me. Brother, he's sitting there agreeing with me the whole service. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You hear the message given in tongues by Sister Patsy in the interpretation. Love. Because if you're bound by bitterness all against somebody, it's hurting you as much or more than it's hurting them. Again, I speak from experience. This one incident out of many that I had the biggest problem over. I said, God, please don't let me run into them in the post office or in the store. Because I don't know how to act. They literally tried to destroy me over lies. Yeah, and I don't know how to act. Ruined my name and tried to all over the county. I didn't know how to act. I thought, Brother Louie, I said, if I ever do, I think that I'll just hide and keep going. God said, that's not good enough. Yeah, I'm not talking about y'all, I'm talking about me right now. But if you're in that boat, I'm talking to you. I said, huh? I get praying, I get thinking about it. God said, you still got some bitterness in your heart toward me. Oh, God, please. Don't expect me. Don't expect that out of me. Because I just can't do it. can't do it. I can't. I'm not can't. He said, until you can go up, stick a hand and ask them how they are. Don't you ever expect to have the anointing you got. And after a lot of praying and a lot of seeing his face, it's been over 20 years since I've seen this person. But I know in my heart, Brother Louis, if I do and I get a chance, I'm going to go up, shake the hand, and say, I love you. How you been doing? Mm-hmm. Amen. Sister Brenda, I want you to know we still love you. I know I could do that. At one time, I couldn't. But I know I can. And when I got to that place, whoo, campaign started coming. Revival started coming. Doors started opening. Y'all, some of y'all looking at me like, I don't like this. Amen. I'm talking about sat down.
Right.
And doors started opening. Campaign started coming about. Come on. I preached North Alabama camp meeting, South Alabama camp meeting the same year. Come back and preach South Alabama two more times at different times. North Alabama the very next year. The only pastor they said since the campground started in the 30s that he ever had the same speaker back to back. It's after I got to the point that I knew if I could see them again. I mean, we said, God, let me see them so I can tell them I love them. I'm talking about putting that ring around them, so to speak. Come on, somebody say amen. But Brother Ronnie, you don't know. Yes, I do. I've been there.
Oh, yes.
I've been there. Been there more than once, but just once in particular. I could have handled the truth. I couldn't handle the lie. Hallelujah, somebody. Love. Love is where your joy lies. Love is where your victory lies. Love. It's where your anointing lies. Would you stand? When the Philistines come and said to the Israelites, if y'all turn Samson over to you, we won't destroy your cities. We won't, there was more power and armor than ever. And they went to Samson. His own people. I said, his own people. Said, Samson, if we turn you over to the enemy, they'll back off and won't destroy us. You know what Samson said? He says, go ahead and turn me over to them, but don't y'all turn against me. I can handle my enemy, but my own people, I don't know how I could handle it.
Right.
That's when he took the jawbone of an ass and slew 1,000 of them. Huh? Have you been hurt by somebody in church? Is there still some bitterness there? You ever been hurt by somebody that's not in church? And there's still some bitterness there. You better heed this message if you want the joy and the anointing in your life. I was sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore.
Am I?
yourself, physically, spiritually, or whatever, for your comfort. Amen. Well, love, lift it.